Okay guys, so here is my first vlog. Today I am basically going to tell you guys about myself because I've never really let you in much and I feel like that's the best thing to do right now to ideally strengthen the bond. So here's my room. Here's Stitch. This is my favorite Disney character ever. He's very relatable. Okay. So today I am basically going to be telling you guys about myself. Currently, I'm in a huge state of paranoia, just due to my past and just the things and the people I've associated myself with previously. I've tried to put myself in a position to ideally be able to motivate others to, I mean, for myself to suffice when it comes to this negative shit, because, like, bro, this shit, it's like trying to consume me. It's almost like it's trying to get inside of my mind, you know? I apologize for being so distant. I've been paranoid, I've been needing help, and I haven't been getting the ideal help I really want.
Give me a sec.
He was moving like he was on a mission. I remember being at these shows and watching how much he controlled the stage, watch how commanding his voice, actions were, like he was a natural leader.
I'm gonna count down to three. When I say it, your motherfuckers jump. One, two, three.
Hey, all I've been doing is your mess. Hey, can't keep my dick in my pants. My bitch don't love me no more. Hey, she kicked me out of life, bro.
I always felt like people used the term rapper to describe him mostly because he was black. But he was never a rapper. He could rap, but I don't think that means you're a rapper.
Okay, she keep calling, everything I'm not.
So many different things with rock and R&B and hip hop, and I'm like, yo, how did the kid that made that made this?
He figured out a way to create X, and he found ways to get attention to himself, and even though it was negative things, it worked.
For him to do all the things that he's done in 2 years, it was incredible. You know, that's the main reason why we're all so hurt. Everybody was so excited to see this next step in the transformation that we never got to see.
The rapper XXXTentacion has been shot, apparently.
XXXTentacion, a rising star here in South Florida.
Police say the artist, whose real name is Jose Onfroy, was leaving a Broward County motorcycle shop yesterday when he was shot by two men who ran up to his car.
The deep connection that his fans have with his music, that's a fact. That's a real thing. His music obviously means so much to so many.
X's music saved my life.
For 3 years, this dude helped me get through depression and a bunch of stuff, man.
Long live X! Long live X! Long live X!
But the thing about his fame and commercial success, it started with this horrific alleged crime.
15-year-olds will in some ways idolize him, and he was an incredible talent. He should not be anyone's idol.
Show some respect and leave it alone. You know, not make a mockery of a man's life and death.
The internet is a place for just a big conversation. He was the topic of the conversation anytime he did anything.
You know, there's been a lot of fucking pressure in the media and shit to not fuck with this dude. And I also just want to say, fuck anybody who's disrespected him after his death.
I do think he was changing. It's just that he left behind the things that hurt others and himself.
We just knew violence sells, and it's the type of energy that we're tapping into to sell shit, you know what I mean? And that's basically what we used it as.
You got me nice lighting, so I can look pretty.
Getting more popular, a big debate that you've sparked, if you've read a lot of stuff about you, I don't know if you have or not, is whether or not you can separate art from an artist, right?
In my situation, they definitely should pay attention to what I am as a person rather than a character. But it is hard to mend these two things together if everything that I portray as an artist is purely art. So it's hard to tell if as a person that anything that is controversial or spoken on about me is remotely even true. You never know who you're fucking with unless you fully dwell into them as a person. So I definitely think it is very, very important to understand who you are fucking with and who you're listening to. Yes, I do.
So, why did you decide to make this documentary?
I decided to make this documentary because I felt like my son's story needed to be told. I was in labor for 24 hours. He came out super light skin, gray eyes, and I was like, oh my God, where did he come from? And he was my little Tweety bird. He was small and cute and yellow. He was just a calm, beautiful baby. Very serious kid. It was as if he was an old soul.
I knew Jaffa was special. The name Jaffa came from Bob Marley. Who he would call God, we as Rockefellers would say Jah. So Jah is God. God said, from the mouth of God, and I made him Jaffa.
Jaffa's dad would come sometimes, pick him up on the weekends. We would share him during holidays or summers and whatnot. He just didn't help us financially. I was 17 when I had him. In my case, I didn't have any support, so it's just me paying rent, paying all the bills, and having to work. And so Jaffa was always with a babysitter or at daycare. I would make sure that he had the best of everything, for sure. I would say he was extremely spoiled. But I think he always felt alone. His father loved him, and he was present until he couldn't be. He got arrested after Jaffa turned 10, and he got 10 years in prison. He hasn't physically saw him in person since then.
When I was growing up, my mom tried to give me love by financially taking care of me because she seen that as the most important thing. As long as I ate, and as long as I had clothes, and as long as I had a place to stay, that was the most important thing to her. She was never able to emotionally nurture me, so that left some sort of and self-hate for myself because I felt like I wasn't enough, you know, for a certain amount of time.
There was like a shift in his behavior, a shift in his personality. At the age of 10, he just started wilding out.
He would like act up in school, you know, class disruption, fights a lot. I stayed on him 24/7 and we would bump heads and we did not get along. When he was 13, we got him evaluated and they told me that he was bipolar. They wanted me to put him on medication and I refused because where I'm from, we don't label kids. And I don't really believe in, you know, dosing kids up with drugs or anything like that. I would prefer going through counseling and trying to get to the root of the problem. And we did that. It just got really, really bad. He was able to get kicked out of every school in our district, which is why he ended up living with my mom.
Go and take the picture while I can take gossip. You play so much, man.
My mom, she lives like right across the street from the hood. And he just made his way over there. And he enjoyed it. He started skipping school. At the time, he would always say, I want to be a rapper. And so, as an incentive, I offered to, you don't have to get straight A's. Just stay in school, don't get in any problems, and I would have him go to the studio on the weekends.
He's showing signs of corruption that went from something to nothing. Put his hands on his mother, and now he's fucking his cousin. Now she's happy.
I remember him making his like first song at like 14, and we were like, yo. Like, we didn't expect that at all. It was like almost like he was telling a whole story. That was like the first time we heard him like curse too.
It was very inappropriate, but I was like, all right, you got something.
All my life, I dream these things. Seems surreal that I see these things. Until I D-I-E, all you niggas just P-I-E. Nah, nigga can't sleep on me.
I kept up my end of the bargain until it didn't work anymore. He was caught up in a few home invasions. He was caught selling drugs. He was caught with a gun. He had all types of charges.
Is it rolling?
Yeah, I'm just gonna roll.
All right. Hi, my name is XXX.
My name is Ski Mask, the slump.
God, I have a skinny dick.
I don't know what you're talking about. Honestly, I didn't know what to make of Jase at first. I met him in juvenile jail. I was at least 16. I think he was younger than me at the time. He told me his charges, and I was like, this nigga's in here for armed robbery? for home invasions? I'm like, okay. What really connected us was we would be beatbox, like making beats on the table, on the chairs and shit, and we would just be freestyling.
A little of vanity goes in, but we can't sit half, but I leave him half alive in a basket, and if you're not a savage, come to the madness.
We would just like feed off of each other. We both were the big brother and little brother at the same time to each other. We didn't even know what we wanted to do at the time. We just know we wanted to make a stand for who we are and just be ourselves, say fuck it, like no matter the consequences. At that point, we were like, we don't really want a job. And if we need a job and the job doesn't want us because we have face tats, then that's not the job we would really want for ourselves or some shit. Like, fuck it, this is what we're doing.
Real piece of shit.
Dirty piece of shit.
Back then, we were stealing shit. Well, I was. I was stealing cough syrup and selling it. We were just having a lot of jugs, really, back then. And we found a lot of ways to make money, but because our parents wasn't helping us with nothing, really, because they just thought we were fucking horrible kids at the time. I remember Cleo's mom picking me and Jase up one day, and this is the first time I meet the lady. And she says, why are you hanging out with him? He's a bad kid. This is what she tells me. He's a bad kid. Why are you chilling with this boy? I feel like a lot of times Jase did feel like even his family didn't really like him at that point. He didn't understand how his family treated him. Like, he was just this bad child. But if you think in Ja's mind back then, Ja didn't think that he was just this bad child trying to rebel. Ja thinks he's just being Ja. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just being me and niggas hate me. And I hate myself because niggas hate me and I need to change myself, basically. I've seen him literally choose to sleep on the streets more times than go home. He didn't explain it to me all the time, but I just knew he even felt better sleeping with me in the car.
When he left home. Nobody kicked him out. And it was as a result of him not wanting to follow the rules or not follow curfew or just doing whatever he wanted to do.
And then he just stopped going to school. He just was like, yo, I'm good.
I don't even know why we wanted a group at the time, but I was like, nah, we gotta make a group of some kind. And I was like, very rare. And me and Ja rode that shit out till the wheels fell off. And then out of nowhere, Ja wanted to make his own group too. And that was members only.
Ja used to always be like, I'm about to start this shit called Members Only, bro. There was really no like planned creation. It was kind of just like a manifestation type of thing for him, you know? And it was kind of like a brotherhood.
Mostly everybody would come to my house. We had a backyard and we would just like sit back there and smoke and write lyrics and listen to Madden.
Slapbox. Ja ordered a Snowball microphone, like one of the cheapest microphones you could get, and we just started recording on it. We were recording in bedrooms, my friend's bedroom, friend's closet. It doesn't matter what it was. He would pull that little thing out with the three prongs, and we would just record that shit. And that's why our music came with distortion, because the type of mic that we were using, but we would use it to our advantage, really.
It was like the SoundCloud era of rap. We didn't know what we was doing.
People loved the first song that Ja dropped on his SoundCloud recently, was Vice City. I seem depressed, always being bothered, nevertheless, keeping me out of prison and putting me to the test. They ask me what is happiness, it's writing on the check. Are you feeling on the sweat when your dick is in the breast, huh?
What really had us notice, what really like rang bells where we're from, was the shows.
Ja always had this aura about him that he was not gonna let us not be accepted.
I'm not gonna run this bitch until y'all come up.
We would pull up 67 deep, and we're gonna grab everybody else off them walls.
So he always had a huge crowd of people around him, and then everybody looking at it like, what the fuck is this, or who is he?
No, real shit. I appreciate all y'all for coming out here. Yeah. Even if you didn't come out here for me, man, but all the support of all y'all, man.
He had a way of making people feel wanted, needed, important, and that's what would gravitate them towards him.
He was so comfortable showing his vulnerability. It kind of made kids relate to him. They reach out to him and say, bro, you saved my life.
Yeah, I seem to find someone's shoulder.
I got into that creative process and really being imaginative and really thoroughly like studying the dictionary and thesaurus, and I really started liking making music, and then I started using it to kind of cope and as an antidepressant. I found a new comfortability within myself when I recorded music. I done my nails.
Bad. All right, this is working, I guess. Hi, you guys.
Let's wait till we get more people. Damn, bro, it's already 100. Jesus Christ. Already 200? Jesus Christ. All right, I fuck with y'all. Y'all out here going hard. I left my DMs open. That's what nobody realizes. My DMs are open so people can talk to me because I really like to, like, talk to my fans. I don't like to just be an ignorant asshole and act like nobody's there, you know? That's why, like, when I get depressed, I realize that I have you guys, and it motivates me to be a different person. It motivates me to not be so fucking down, you know? Like, look at this. We've had over 1,000 people in here, and, like, I'm just one person, you know? So to have that many people supporting me, you not know how awesome that feels. That's fucking awesome.
A lot of people know me as Bruno Dickums. I've been a porn star for about 12 years. I created my own website.
You gotta show us some skin, baby. Skin to win.
We shot reality-type porn. I followed around artists in the underground scene. Me meeting a lot of artists, you know, I decided that I wanted to manage some of these artists because I saw a lot of potential. You know, I was going to a lot of the shows, and there was one guy that was starting to make a little noise in South Florida. I didn't know who he was. And everybody around me is like, it's the kid we're telling you about, X. You know, he's like coming up in the scene.
We weren't on the level that he was on. It was him and Ski on a particular level, and it was our job to help that grow and formulate. He started off by networking with artists that was already running the South Florida underground scene. Wi-Fi was one of those people that already was up there. Rob was another one, he was already up there. Danizel.
I just saw his energy. Like, it's hard to explain. Like, just his presence, like, he could make noise in a room and not even speak. These kids, man, they look like they were ready to die for a job. It was already XXX that thus, you know. The way he got that name, he came up with that name, was his, you know, infatuation with porn. So once he heard, oh, there's this porn star that shoots porn with underground artists, he's like, oh, this is the guy I gotta meet. So I think he was living with his grandma. And he started coming over more than he was supposed to. So I was like, you come in here a lot. And I wake up in the morning, sleep on the couch. I'm like, hey, man, you don't live here. Like, he's like, bro, where I'm at, man, I'm going crazy. Like, I need to be somewhere else. Like, please let me move in. I was like, all right, I'll officially be your manager. You can move in. When I started managing Ski, too.
When he was able to stay at Bruno's, I think he was able to hone in on his artistry, like the screamo type distorted beat. No one was delivering like him, you feel me?
This is like one of the first times we've seen Ja yell at the mic. The porn girls in the house was going in here like, what the fuck is wrong with this nigga, dog? We were literally living in a porn house. We would see crazy shit every day. And then the rages at the concerts, like all the energy just mashed. We were living it.
I think that's when things started picking up for him, because he started making better songs because he was able to jump into that character, if you know what I mean. And on top of that, he was doing a lot of shit, like he was beating niggas up on camera and shit.
Hey, Periscope. So we got a very, 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 very extra interesting story today. So basically, this nigga that owes us some cash pulled up to the crib, and he thinks we're cool with him. So my manager was letting him kick it in there. But basically, I'm about to just beat this nigga's ass, and you guys get to watch it firsthand.
If anybody fucked with X's friends, X is gonna deal with it. The kid he beats up in the bathroom was somebody that owed me money. And I told the kid, man, if you can't pay me the $500, we're gonna have to fight this out. We're gonna have to record this for my website. Are you cool with it? He agreed with it. X pulls up. He's like, where is he at? We need to shoot this scene. I was like, he's in the house, but we're doing this scene tomorrow. So please, can we just wait? Because I know if you go and try to fight him now, this scene's not going to happen, you know? Yeah, he didn't listen.
Yeah. Come here, bro. Come here.
Honestly, there would be times where I'd be like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy? There's something not right with this guy. That's when people didn't really want to be around Ja. To be completely honest, a lot of people that was around Ja didn't want to be around Ja before Ja got onto shit. People hated Ja, to be completely real.
Come on.
come on, brother.
Mm-hmm. Fucking play with me, bro.
He was a small dude, but he had a very loud Napoleon complex to him.
I was always the person that people would be coming to calm Jose down. I basically was always the one that looked him in the face. And I'm just like, I'm here, bro. And I'm going to be here for you. And I think I was one of the first people to really do that for him and be show him that I'm going to love you either way. That's why he really loved me and felt like I was one of his true, really true best friends, because no matter what crazy shit Ja did, I had to look him in the eye and hug him and tell him I loved him for him to understand that you're going to get better. Ja hated himself at one point and a lot of points.
What do you think the things that he struggled with, what are some of the things that he struggled with?
Emotions. I feel like he hated his own anger, you know what I mean? And he was trying to learn how to control that, his emotions, basically, and not let them get the best of him. That was really just his biggest battle, himself, really, yeah. It took a series of things for Ja to get the way he was. I mean, Ja used to tell me he used to see his mom get beat up when he was younger or some shit like that, Cleo.
His dad tried to put his hands on me a few times. It didn't work out well. I didn't call the cops on him, because where I'm from, that's also taboo. But I hauled ass real quick. I wasn't about to be nobody's, my story don't go like that. You know, we're Jamaican, so we're used to ass whoopings. Like, we get our ass beat, like, with hoses and 2x4s and you name it. And so it's passed on from generation to generation. I don't know if his dad beating him with anything crazy, but he would snuff him and he would like beat him if he would tell him to study his timetables, if he would get something wrong. So whenever he would get in problems at school, dad would come give him a whooping, a good one. But he wasn't abusive. I wouldn't say he was abusive or anything like that.
We was born into a world that taught us that men have to fight, and this has been going on for thousands of years before we even came here. So if this is the way the world works, our parents, big brothers, big cousins don't want us to be at a disadvantage. So when my big cousins used to be beating my ass as a kid, they was training me to not get my ass beat as an adult.
Same on this end.
So at the same time, it's like, it might affect us negatively, personally, but generally, generally, you feel me? Generally, it protects us. Mm-hmm. It's like your weapon can also be the same thing that kills you.
If you got fear, it's hard to be angry. If you got someone that you're scared of in your life, it's real hard to be angry. Dad got locked up when I was like 10. Who was out of fear? My mom. Who was out of fear? Some stranger. I feared nobody. So my anger took control. And whenever anybody would do anything to me, I would act out on it. Fear left, so anger replaced it.
Like everything that he did when it came to beef and fighting and popping off, even though it was mental instability there, he was still going live and he recorded, knowing goddamn well this is good for my career.
I guess he just knew what they wanted to see and he just took advantage of it, just like anybody else would.
I would do little things that I knew would get people's attention. This is what people want to see. I said, I know what to market. And I just started marketing bullshit that I knew the kids would like to get them to go on my page, because obviously I would post shit on my page, and then they would be like, oh, well, this nigga makes music. Let me try it. Let me look and listen to this and see what it's like. And then I would catch you. That's how I would catch you.
Jose would make us make multiple Twitter accounts. 25 people in the chat, and each of those people have at least 5 different Twitter accounts, and we all retweeting this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we all go to sit there on Twitter and talk shit to anybody that come under there talking shit and just fuck up the algorithms in our favor. It was just like a...
draw attention. It was all planned out and very strategic.
All these people want to see is us destroy each other.
That's what they pay for.
All controversy. Mm-hmm.
So if you're telling us, if you're paying us to destroy each other, then we will become gladiators. What do you expect us to do?
If you need it, I might punch you. I'm not getting on my life. Make your head.
Oh, see if they fuck with that soft shit. I dropped like some soft shit. Tell me if y'all fuck with it.
He came to my house and he was like, bro, I got something really different. Like, really different. Like, I'm singing. Like, I'm like, you ain't singing, bro. You used to yelling and screaming on tracks and being angry. And you say, I don't want to do this anymore. I'm like, and he's looking at me and I'm looking at him. And I'm like, bruh. You just went from doing this hype rock rap shit to R&B. How did? And after that, I knew he was gonna be great. Once he made that song, I was like, he can do it all now.
I don't wanna love myself. I'm praying that you don't love me.
There is no definition to my raps. Like, I'm versatile. If you give me the tools to make what the fuck I want, proper studio, proper engineering, even the people that will sit there and take their work very seriously, and like as far as the production, I'll be the greatest artist there possibly is.
Really?
Literally.
The first time I went to one of his shows, I was amazed. There was kids lined up on the side of the stage with their sneakers to get autographs, and I was like, what is this? Is this my child? You know, and it was like a proud moment.
I started noticing that X, you know, was getting in his feelings. He was feeling a little lonely. And him being a hopeless romantic, he's like, I need a girlfriend. It's going to help me focus. It's going to help me be creative. Because some of the music he was making was, you know, a lot of that R&B love stuff. So I guess he needed something to actually make it real, make it sound real.
I met Jose 2014. I was in high school. I met him, like, online.
Look at this fucking hair. I was supposed to be a mystical-ass lion, and I ended up being a fuck-ass human. What the fuck?
At 17, I was basically homeless or home-hopping. I was always getting, like, bullied. I was just always on the laptop, basically, and trying to, like, make friends online. I'd go on chat rooms and live through there.
Look at what we have here.
I would just try to keep myself happy through friends. When Jose and I first met, I had cuts on my thigh, like 5 lines, and under that I had the word that said alone. And when he noticed it, he was like, why'd you do that? And I was like, because I felt alone. He was like, oh, me too. Like, I feel like we're the same in that aspect.
I just felt like I found my significant other. I felt like I found my soulmate. I said, I want you to cut alone into my arm. So every time you feel as if you're alone, you think of me and you understand you have someone that feels exactly the same.
Depression and obsession makes
me. I was living in a motel. I didn't even have like a pillow. I was just sleeping on an air mattress with my uncle. So he gave me a pillow at his house and gave me a jacket. It's like he didn't want me to feel like I didn't have anything, even if he had to like sacrifice his own thing.
I was like, yo, do you like sleeping alone? She said, no. I said, neither do I. I said, I know that you stay in a motel. So how about I go back to the motel with you and I'll sleep in the lobby? She said, are you serious? Would you do that for me? I said, yeah.
Hollywood motels, hell, I think I'm just obsessed with you.
It was the only person I had around for a while that I felt relevant to, despite, like, besides my mom.
I realized that he had a girlfriend, so I basically fell back. And after those 3 days, we didn't hang out. We really didn't have contact either.
I didn't hear from her for 2 to 3 years.
When we met up again, I was 19. My best friend at the time, she invited me to a show. We're all tied, waiting to get into the venue. And I see him, yeah, like no shirt on. You know, it was like dark and steamy. And
he locked eyes with me from across the room, and then he's like started walking up to me. He just like grabs me by the neck and looks at me like deep in my eyes. I'm like, oh. Spotlight. New white trip, get you Mariah. Should look good in the moonlight. All these pussy niggas so bad, Maya. Spotlight. And he just walks away after that. And then I just look at my friend. I'm like, yeah, I don't know what that was, but it was sexy.
We started dating after that date, and I moved in with him.
He would post me on his Snapchats, and all my friends were hitting me up like, you date X? And then he started like bringing me around places, and people would notice him, and like they just go crazy for him. I just didn't realize it. I didn't know.
Go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead. Let me see how weird you is.
It was kind of a romantic feel in the beginning. It was a mesh between like always taking care of each other and trying to better ourselves.
He tried to put her fucking finger in my mouth and got a bit in my mouth.
Uh-huh. Stop it.
Bite you that shit, you fuck ass nigga. Say sorry.
I'm sorry. Sorry as fuck. Sorry as fuck.
They stayed in this room most of the time. I barely saw them. But I just saw how the obsession wasn't healthy.
When I moved in with Jose, I was working at an animal hospital. I was getting paid $10 an hour. That was my first good paying job. Like a week later, he was like, we're not gonna drive you back and forth from Fort Lauderdale to North Miami every day. So you're gonna have to quit. You're fine anyway, like I got you. And then I quit. I understood like off the bat when he cared about something, it was impossible for you to like just hear him from that.
There was also a lot of miscommunication and jealousy, I'd say.
So sorry.
You know, I was depressed somewhat when I was with him because I felt like he was like the only person that would give me love, and like I wouldn't find that anywhere else. So that's why like I continuously stayed. It had its good moments and bad moments, but mostly like I was lost. I didn't really know like what to do about it.
Hey, so we got this new call. We got this new call called RP Roach. Hey, where's he at? Hey,
he was kind of buzzing at that point. He was making like underground hits, you know what I mean? And then people start peeping like, oh, he might be the next one up. You feel me? But I'm not gonna lie. I think his mind state was very bad at that point. The thing about Jaws, if you weren't that close to him, he didn't really want you to see like his true personality sometimes. So he always, you feel me, throwing a little mask or something to try to hide how he's feeling in the moment. So that's how he was treating me at that time. He was trying to be very calm, you feel me? Yo, what's good? How you doing? But he was in a bad mental state, though, I could tell. Yeah.
This is the first time I'm letting them see my hair.
My hair is just a reminder of telling me to fucking relax, basically. It's a reminder of me telling myself that, yo, you are human and that you are not a god. You are still on the planet Earth, and that you need to remind yourself that karma is a real thing, and whatever you give out, you will get back.
I knew that something was off. The voices in the head came. He would tell me, like, he would not sleep at night, and he would tell me he hears voices.
Literally, you'd be like, oh, I took LSD and I talked to a spirit that's a demon and told me information about myself, about how long I'm gonna live, that they're gonna come get him at some point. I really didn't like that shit at that point.
Yeah, it was a very dark time.
And if I end up getting shot and killed for what the fuck I'm doing, or if I end up getting my ass beat at some point in time, or nigga, if shit get hard on me, it's because I deserve it. That's point blank, period. Everybody will get a death. Everybody will get a death that is deserving. Everybody will get a life that is deserving. Everybody, you will get what the fuck you deserve, karma.
I was 23 in the summer of 2016 when I met Jose.
I was at the time dating Cade Moulton, which was his producer. Jase was about 18 at the time. Jase was not a monster. Like, when I met him, he was very charming, very intelligent, empathetic in a sense. Like, damn near surprised me. The first day I saw Geneva, when she came out, she was wearing a hoodie. She just wasn't making eye contact with anybody. She'd look up and just, like, go back down. She was literally just a shell of a person. Like, there was just no expression. There was nothing. I felt like her soul was empty at the time. One day, Cade cracked a joke in the car. She kind of giggled and laughed. And Jase, like, cut his eyes to her and was like, when we get to the house, go in the room. And I was kind of like, the fuck? Kind of just came clear that he was not happy with her laughing at his joke. They went in the rooms and I could hear them fighting. Eventually you just hear somebody was getting hit. Jase had a bathroom in that, a private bathroom in the room. So you could hear water running and I'm thinking, okay, maybe they're gonna take a shower or whatever, but no. He was literally drowning her in the tub, like putting her under, and you could hear her screams being muffled by the water and being put up and then being put back under the water. And I was banging on the door, begging Cade, like, bro, I'm calling the cops. And he's begging me, don't call the cops, bro. Like, you know, I got a situation in Georgia, which he did. So I didn't. Big regret. Later that night, she finally came out again and she, like, picked up her hoodie and she was marked up with bruises like a Dalmatian, like a bruise behind her ear, behind her neck, literally everywhere. And it was very clear that he was avoiding hitting her face so that she wouldn't have any, like, clear injuries when you were talking to her. I've never seen somebody bruised up so bad. It was just very clear, like, she didn't have nobody. Like, she didn't have any money. She didn't have any family support. So in a situation like that, when people are like, why don't you leave? Why don't you leave? And you really don't, you think that that person is literally your foundation and your network to life.
Until I started fucking her up. Now she's scared. And really scared for her life, which I understand. You know what I've done, people. All them boys know. She know that. She's seen this shit. So she's scared. She thinks I'm gonna kill her.
They all knew what was going on, and they were so caught up in his clout and having his respect, they would never go against what he was saying. It was like the weight of that person, it was zero compared to their potential to make it with Jase. So there was just no incentive to step in.
You know how you got that little voice in your head and it'd be like, yo, don't do that? I don't think he had that in certain moments, if you get what I'm saying. So he used to just be like, bro, niggas drop me. All right, let's go. You feel me? That, so if you don't have that in your head, you kind of got to have somebody around you to be like, yo, bro, we good, bro. It's not that big of a deal. You feel me? Let's just vibe. And I don't think that was the thing. I don't really think he had that in Orlando.
Yeah, he was in jail and I was with a group of his friends. You know, they were like taking care of me and stuff all until he got back. And I ended up cheating on Jase with his homeboy. Once it came out, like, Jase at first said that he would deal with it and he would get over it, but he couldn't get over it, it seems.
He did come to me and was like, hey, Geneva was pregnant, what do I do? I couldn't really answer that question. I was like, yeah, just be there for her. That's it, you know? You can't be here, especially now she's pregnant.
If I was there, I don't think it would have went that far. I don't think I would have left Geneva alone for a second with him. And that's what happened when she was attacked. She was left alone. From what I understand, like, they held her there for like 3 or 4 days and wouldn't let her see the hospital. I remember when she said how she escaped, because I was like, how the fuck did you get out of that shit? He was playing PlayStation or Xbox or something, and she opened up the fridge and kind of let that be a distraction, like she was looking in the fridge, and she said she got on her fours and crawled out of the house while the fridge was still open and ran out. I had nowhere to run. I don't have any brothers. I don't have a father figure. Nobody was gonna come save me. I had to leave. I felt like it was gonna get worse. The first person I called when I ran away from the house was my ex-boyfriend, because literally besides my mom, that was like the only phone number I knew by heart. And he seen my face and he's like, okay, this is crazy. I have to call my mom. His mother was like, she can't be with you because they're gonna think you did that. She literally drove me to the station. She was like, go, because you're not staying with us like that. I didn't want nobody to go to jail, but I didn't know what to do. I wasn't aware that that would all like crumble down onto him like that.
You gotta be fucking kidding me. Like, that's the first thing I thought. Like, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Like, like, you just gotta be fucking kidding me. Like, there was no other ways to think about it.
You know, I knew he was a lot of things and get into a lot of shit, but that was new to me. That part was foreign to me. But I was shocked at how bad it was. Already out on bond when that incident happened. He had racked up so many points that, you know, he was going to jail for a very long time.
Cleo in her mind was like, I'm gonna have to take care of him his whole life because he has a record, tattoos on his face. Like, it was exhausting just running, like, not knowing what the next option was for him.
All right, so I'm gonna ask Geneva, I need you to speak for yourself. Can you hear me, Geneva?
Yeah.
When he called me, I was really nervous. I was like, okay, this is a jail phone call. I answer it.
All right, are you with me or against me?
I'll fucking drop the charges, but you already said that.
No, no, no.
Might get in trouble, shit.
Because I don't want you to end up in jail. If you drop the charges, you're gonna end up in jail, Geneva. I have to find a way around it.
He was telling me that I would go to jail, and I was scared of that. But then he would tell me that he loved me, and that he cared about me. He didn't want anything to happen to me. So there was still like a little bit of manipulation, and I was just like so confused.
I don't want you in jail, Geneva. I love you.
It's gonna drop eventually if I do not show up to court. If I don't show up to court and I don't. Yeah.
Exactly. That's what
I know.
That's what I'm gonna make you do.
That's what we were gonna do regardless. The fact that he got in the amount of trouble that he did get into, it was not my intention. I just needed to get away from it.
Of course we believe him.
We're family. We hate to see one of our own be incarcerated, you know? Especially for an allegation, you know? And he's literally sitting rotten in jail for an allegation
almost
that...
Almost a year.
That shit felt forever.
Everybody was like, he's arrested because of his girlfriend. And I'm like, well, this is why. When I told my piece about the situation, fans were not very understanding because obviously the person that they look up to is saying one thing and then I was saying the complete opposite. Obviously, they're not gonna believe me.
The fans are toxic. So they get an ear of things, they're going to start making up their own narratives and start twisting things and contorting it. And so now it's this on social media. Whether he did it or not, for people to make it public, all that shit brings attention towards him.
I wanna say we were on Instagram and ASAP Rocky was like, yo, Free X, that's the hottest nigga out of Florida right now, right?
Free my nigga XXX. I can't wait till you come home. Fuck is you talking about? He the hardest nigga in Florida. I said it. So what, you don't like
it? Would literally became like a hashtag. Like, his mugshot went viral.
The first image I ever saw of Jase was his mugshot, and it was probably the most polarizing image of an artist I've ever seen in my life. He had tattoos on his face, half blonde, half black hair. He had this stare in his eyes. His eyes almost looked black. His image, it was exciting, was polarizing. I knew that people wouldn't forget him because he was the first of his kind. Bitch, you a germ ass, ayy. Can't keep my dick in my pants,
ayy. My bitch don't love me no more, ayy. She kicked me out of life, bro. Unfortunately, we're living in a world where drama and bullshit sells. And so as bad as that was, it helped to catapult him to the next level because his name was everywhere. And then the Drake beef added to it.
But it was the fans who started saying something about Drake stealing this flow.
That's how we found out.
He was jammed.
Because the fans were speaking up before us.
Oh yeah.
We don't even listen to Drake. Demon just got out of camp. I gave my bro an advance. Love is just not in my plan. My life is you as your mess. Ay. Can't keep my dick in my pants. Once the fans started speaking, it all started speaking for itself.
People were fighting about the music, fall in love with the music. People were fighting about the charges, hating him for the charges. Like, he was only getting more famous by the day. Whether you loved it or whether you hated it, you just had to acknowledge it. Look at me, fuck on me, look at me, fuck on me, look at me, fuck on me, look at me, yo. Look at me, fuck on me, look at me, fuck on me, look at me, fuck on me, look at me, yo.
I had labels started reaching out to me because he was locked up. Regardless of whether me and him fought like cats and dogs, he knew that I always had his best interests at heart. Who was he gonna trust? You know what I mean? I'm his mama. So he gave me power of attorney. You know, I was kind of like, oh, we should sign. He was like, no, mom, if we can hold on and stay independent, that's where the real bag is. Seeing other people being screwed in the industry, he knew very well and from early that he wanted to own all his masters. He knew what the end game and the end goal was. Solomon found us, actually. I was intrigued by that.
You know, I saw pictures of him, of course, but, like, I don't know, in my mind, like, I was expecting him to be, like a giant almost when I saw him. And then when I saw him behind the glass, it was just kind of crazy because he was a kid. All this craziness, and he's just a kid. Like, he had all the hope in the world, and you could see he was vulnerable. So at that point, I'm just like, yo, no matter what, yo, I got this kid. I got him.
We got our first deal while he was locked up.
We got that 100 grand to license Look At Me to Empire, and it was off to the races from there.
At the time where you came across Look At Me, are you aware of what had happened to make those numbers start jumping?
No, I really didn't give a fuck, to be honest. That wasn't a concern to me. I just knew that the record was special, it was moving, and I just started chasing it. I think my first contact with him was Bob called me on three-way with him in prison. And we talked for a couple minutes, and he told me he had a couple other deals that he was looking at, so on and so forth. And he called me back with Bob on the phone. He said, I'm gonna do your deal. And I said, I don't understand. Why would you do our deal versus the other deal? And mind you, the other deal was like a traditional multi-album deal, large advance. I think the advance was like 1.5 million, he told me. My offer was like 100K for like two singles. And I asked him, I said, why would you do my deal over the other deal? You're only like 18, bro. That's a lot of money. He said, because your deal makes me a partner and their deal makes me a slave.
I still feel like I'm dreaming. I feel like I just broke up out this bitch. Yeah, don't go to jail in Broward County.
Don't go to jail, bro.
They not finna let you out. Oh, that boy can't have that. You look fresher than a bitch.
Yo, my nigga. Oh, my goodness.
This shit about to be crazy. Oh, goodness.
I'm gonna call my mom.
Oh, shit, bro. You out?
Nigga.
Look, FaceTime.
Huh?
FaceTime.
I'm a
girl, baby. Do it. Hi, princess. You look beautiful. What are you talking about?
I look horrible. Are you kidding?
You look like sex.
How does it feel to be free?
I feel like crying. I'm about to get on my knees. I'm dead ass serious. So I don't come back to the shit.
I'm so happy you're finally out.
Yeah.
You look fresh, bro.
You all look like a jack.
I love you.
I love you. See you in a little bit.
All right, I'm going to call you. Oh, man. Yo, my fucking name comes up, my nigga. Jose D. Onfroy, better known by his stage name XXXTentacion, is an American hip-hop recording artist from Plantation, Florida. Jesus fucking Christ. Well, that's a lot of fucking followers. Hey, holy shit. Hey. What the fuck?
Can't keep my dick in my pants. My bitch don't love me no more. She kicked me out of life, bro. That bitch don't wanna be friends. I give her a dick, she a man. She put her tongue on my dick. Look at my wrist about 10. Fuck on me, look at me. Fuck on me, yeah. Look at me.
Let's take over the fucking world.
Fuck on me, yeah. Fuck on me, yeah.
Oh my God, baby. Put me down, boy. You smell like
cigarettes.
Cigarettes?
Yes, I do.
Wait, are you getting short?
No.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Oh, yeah, I guess you like this jacket better, huh?
Mm-hmm, yes, I do.
Let me pick you up.
If you could. Papa. No, I'm gonna let him sleep.
Yeah, he's not gonna wake up.
Yo, this is hilarious.
Like, yo, bro, you about to have a number one record soon. Do you understand that? You're gonna have a number one record. You about to have the biggest song in the country very soon.
For real.
Very soon.
Viral.
So just leave all the BS alone, bro.
A really important thing is to ignore her.
Ignore her. Ignore her.
Keep away from all that bullshit because it's not worth it. You feel me? Look what you already went through over that.
Understood.
And look where you're going.
Facts.
For real. Look where you're at right now. Like,
now is about your family and about your life, about your career, about you accomplishing everything you ever wanted. That's the only thing that matters, man. Leave everything else in the past, bro, and just make the most out of it. Make your little brother proud. Make your mother proud. Make your family proud, bro. That's everybody wants. It's just to be proud of you, you know what I mean? If you to change the lineage of the Onfroys for the rest of eternity.
Yeah. And you are the example right now. I mean, I'm not saying you're a role model like that, but people are looking at you, and you now have a lot of responsibilities as a grown man.
You hear that, Leo? You got a lot of responsibilities. I'm handing this to you.
As a grown man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I understand.
You're gonna be just fine.
I'm gonna just take it one step at a time.
That's all you can do, man. Just take it one step at a time and just try to do the right thing. Yeah. That's all that counts, man.
This is a story. This is a full story, and this is the last time I will tell it. She was already bruised on her face. All while she was staying with me. She was already bruised on her face. Now, with the severe bruising, I don't know how the fucking severe bruising came about, but she had, like, bruises on the left side of her face when she was at Bruno's. I think she got jumped. That's what I told everybody, like, yo, she got jumped. Cause the way she was fucked up, I think she got jumped. They're not gonna admit to it. I don't give a fuck. That's not my part of the story. But that bitch got whooped bad. So I didn't beat her. Nor do I give a fuck about who beat her at this time, because now I know she's an evil bitch. There's the story.
Jesse was like, no, mom, it's not true. And a part of me, you know, took that and run with it.
What do you think now?
I mean, that's my son. Even if he's Hitler, that's my son. If he's a devil, that's my son. I birthed him. Wrong, right, or indifferent, I'm gonna have his back no matter what, and I'm gonna have his best interests at heart. So naturally for me, I wanna save my child. Any mother would have done the same thing, I would think.
Dancing?
Yeah.
What do you mean I was dancing?
Like whining, like slow.
Oh! I could never repay my mom for the amount of pain that she's been through, and I gave her more. And she still stood there hanging on with broken hands. I could never repay her for that. I am forever in her debt, and I do everything that I still do now for my fans and for my mother. There's most definitely a difference between Jesse Onfroy and XXXTentacion. Nobody cared about Jesse Onfroy. Jesse Onfroy was very meek. Jesse Onfroy was weak.
You're leaving now.
Now. Everybody go.
You take everybody out the door now.
Nobody gave a fuck about me as an individual. Nobody gave a fuck about how I felt. Now my opinion is respected, and every move I make is recorded and calculated. Nobody cared about Jesse Onfroy until he took on the persona as XXX.
Darkness sells. Bad things sells. The shit that your parents tell you not to do sells. You pick up on that shit quick in this industry, so when you're trying to go ahead, that's usually the formula.
I'm gonna make the world hate me. I'm gonna be the super villain. I'm gonna make this whole thing crumble.
People like the villains.
Yeah, they do. I definitely agree. They definitely do. I'm gonna ruin everything for everybody.
Yeah.
When I really knew that we were really doing something crazy was the Revenge Tour.
The shows were huge. I ain't even expect that. I don't even think he expected it.
It was so relieving to see Jaws' efforts of always doing some outlandish shit actually make sense. Like, it was a method to the madness, and it worked hella good.
Jaws was a real showman. Every single night, he's trying to outdo the last night. You know, what could I do that's more memorable than the last night?
I love it, right? Hey, bro, hey. Hey.
We're gonna play this shit, and I'm gonna try and commit suicide, okay? Play this shit.
Being at these shows and watching these kids soak in every word that Josh said, the way he would speak to them at mass would kind of be like a mass. It would be like church for them. It was like a cult, and he would be like their God.
Listen, to win everything in life, you have to acquire your purpose. Now, that state of depression, that basically that mind of depression that we all start off with, when we feel, hold on, when we feel pointless, when we feel like we're not capable of anything, is because we have not found our purpose. You understand? Yeah. Now, when you often find your purpose and you reach for the sky, people often tell you that it's not possible. Now let me ask you something. Do you think you can be right here or right where the fuck do you want to be?
I remember him always telling me, like, I'm making music for the broken people, for the people that feel how I feel.
Why the fuck are y'all reporting me, bruh? I am at Instagram. I'm not fucking posting nothing, bruh. This is not fair. That's the third account I've lost to Instagram because of fucking hating ass ex-fans. And I fucking hate y'all. And I wish I could just take my soul and put it in another fucking body or something because I fucking hate myself because of y'all.
I'm not crying because Instagram is my life, bro. I'm crying because y'all are my income, bro. I
couldn't get a job because the situation was so popular that people would come into the place I worked and they'll just like ask me questions and like the situation's fresh, I would start crying to the point where the managers were like, why are you always crying? Like, we don't need this. And everybody was like, you're ruining his career. But at the same time, I felt like my whole life was ruined because nobody even cared. Like after that, I was homeless. Like I lived in a hotel for like almost a year after that, and the whole time I'm like, everybody hates me, when I was just trying to say what happened. And on top of that, they were asking me what happened. Like, everybody was like asking me what happened, and I'm trying to tell it. If you're gonna think that I'm a liar, I'm a liar. Because how am I supposed to fight that? I'm only one person. It was a really dark moment for me, and there was no way that I could just stop it. He had the power to do all that.
Look at me,
what?
Hey, look at me,
fuck on me.
Look at me, fuck on me. Look at me, fuck on me. Look at me, yeah.
Rolling Loud, make some noise one time for XXX.
I love you. I love you all. Good night.
I can pay your mama house payment. I can pay your mortgage, baby.
95 of these hoes in America.
Ooh, I must say, where can I drive it?
Can't forget. You see this fucking mugshot? On a platinum plaque? Yeah, bitch. Borrow.
They don't want to see a mugshot. I met Jose in early August. He was coming to L.A. to finish his album 17. I was waiting for them in the studio, and while I was waiting for them to show up, I just was kind of playing the guitar, hanging out. And he walked in the studio and introduced himself and was like, you playing guitar? And I'm like, yeah. And then he just started singing something. That night was a long night. I remember he goes into the booth, and he was trying to kind of figure out a certain melody, and the engineer wasn't getting the sound right. I kind of figured out what he wanted in his head and was able to translate that a little bit.
Dead inside, spin a lot of times again, it's here. Like, under the assumption love is dead. Like it.
He was one of those people that had everything in his head. He just didn't know physically how to like translate that into a record. like the process of production. And so I kind of just started fitting in there.
I know a lot of fans, a lot of people thought he was gonna make an album full of look at me's, but instead he made this vulnerable, emotional masterpiece, really. I remember when 17 came out, I was worried at the time because as amazing as I thought the project was, I was like, yo, people are either gonna love this or they're gonna hate this. I didn't really think there was gonna be an in-between. So people loved it.
Tell the feeling like I'm trapped in my damn mind. Tell the feeling like I'm rapping a damn lie. Tell the feeling like my life is a damn game. Nigga really wanna die in the nighttime. Only time I feel pain when I'm feeling low.
I remember Kendrick Lamar giving it praise, and so many people really, really, really surprised at how Ja just left his soul on that project. He just gave it to you. It was raw, it was honest, it was everything. And also nothing like we've ever heard before.
My first article about XXXTentacion was in February 2017, and he was already blowing up. Around the time that X was blowing up was a moment when people were becoming more conscious of what kind of values they wanted to support. It was a strange moment for somebody to be coming up who also had these terrible allegations attached to him. At this point, it was people are listening to his music. People that we respect and admire are recommending his music. There's more to the story. Here's what this young woman said under oath he did to her.
Y'all niggas mad I'm successful?
No, but on some real shit, if you don't like me, refer me to your auntie so I can put my dick in her. Because if y'all really think I ever give about anything y'all be saying, or y'all gonna make me miserable, I'm gonna y'all little sisters and they. I swear to God, everybody that called me a domestic abuser, I'm finna domestically abuse y'all little sister from the back. Fuck, aren't you? Is this making you mad yet? If you hate me, are you mad yet? Are you gonna go on Reddit and post really bad things about me? Hashtag insensitive.
He had gone on social media and I think it was on his story, and he had a girl next to him and they were laughing and giggling, and he made a pretty aggressive remark towards women, and it was pretty bad. I mean, it was bad enough that women in my office were talking about it. And so we all decided to jump on the phone with him. It was me, his mom, Solomon, the criminal attorney, and the entertainment attorney. I don't think anybody else was on the call. It was a group call. And they kind of wanted to address some of his actions, and he wasn't fucking with it. He was really upset. Started yelling at us. He was always adamant that he wanted to express whatever it was he wanted to express, and he didn't give a fuck what anybody had to think about it. And so I remember we hung up the phone, but I called him and I was like, bro, let me holler at you. And he was like, what's up? And I said to him, you know, you've spent all this time building this relationship to your audience on social media, and I know you really love and cherish this role of the villain, and the villain has gotten you pretty far, but I don't think you need to be the villain anymore. You are already popping. Just be who you are. And I don't know, for whatever reason, I don't know if it was that conversation, I don't know if he had other conversations with his mom or his other friends around him or whatever, but I want to say that, like, something definitely changed after that incident. Things started to change with him.
I apologize to anyone I've offended within the last couple of hours. Obviously, you guys know I'm going through a lot just due to this case. If I want to assert myself, in my career or have my views respected, I realize that I have to treat everything with care and take time and have patience with people. I just want people to know that I'm not trying to lead their children down a dark path, and that I really want something good for the human race. So with that being said, I hope everyone has a good day.
There's some issues where people need to be scrutinized. There's some issues where people just need to be put away. You feel me? But there's some issues where people need help, especially kids. He was mature, streetwise, he was mature. He was music, business savvy, you know what I mean? He had a lot of, so he had to have some type of like hustle in his family background, you could tell that. But at the end of the day, like emotionally, he wasn't there yet.
How did his age factor into your perspective on this?
It made me sad. You know, he allegedly did to her what he allegedly did, but that doesn't mean that he didn't suffer as well. That doesn't make him just a two-dimensional person either.
Him battle with his demons from the very beginning. I wish I could have helped more. I didn't know how to help. I didn't know what to do.
It's one of those days where you realize nothing fucking matters. One of those days where you feel like driving off a bridge. Am I really quitting? Yes, I'm quitting. I don't know for how long, but I'm just not gonna make music right now. I mean, it's just been that my mind's been fucked up. My mind has been somewhere else.
He saw a doctor and was diagnosed as bipolar. They were giving him medicine to take. You know, he hated the medicine, of course. Medicine made him dull, uncreative. It was hard for him to be himself.
What are you gonna say now? Isn't it clear I don't give a fuck?
He made himself ugly at one point by shaving off his eyebrows. That's what he called it. Shedding who he was.
If you feel as if your physical identity has to be the same as everyone else's to be socially acceptable, you're stupid. Be yourself.
He wanted to trip acid. I think he was kind of trying to free his mind from everything that was going on. But it was kind of to dig deeper into yourself to understand, like, why you think like this? Why do you act like that? He wanted to shed his skin. He kept saying it to me. He was like, bro, I feel like I don't like this. You feel me? The skin I'm in. He just meant like he wanted to become a better person, you know what I mean? He just kept saying that over and over, and I was like, yeah, I feel you, bro. We gonna get through this. Like, you gonna become a better person, bro. Don't worry.
He was going through a lot, and we would be making songs, and sometimes in between the process, I would kind of leave my phone on, just forgetting about it, and then we would start talking about something. This is one.
In the same sense, though, my paranoia be fucking with me, bro. I just be lost.
Because you be thinking so much, bro.
I do, bro. But I can't turn it off.
Yeah,
you shouldn't turn it off, brother. You gotta accept it.
So how? The my main thing is, how do I control this shit?
Control what?
My thought process.
You can't suppress it. You gotta just. It has to be a relationship with your thoughts. You have to have conversations with your thoughts, you know what I mean? It's like pressure, you know? Pressure builds up and it'll just overload you.
Bro, you make me feel like I got somebody, you feel me? You be having my back. And you show me you got my back, you be mad consistent. That shit makes me happy as fuck. And I never took to men, because, bro, when I was younger, nigga, my mom used to get beat. And you know what I'm saying? She'll fuck with a nigga and you should beat her. I used to have to beat niggas up when I was little. Like, I'm like, bro, it sounds crazy. Yeah, I'm 6, 7 years old, biting niggas in their stomach and all types of crazy shit. Yes, nigga, that's my mom. I left a big ass fart, nigga, beating my mom in front of me, nigga. I'm biting their fucking flesh out their stomach. All types of shit, you feel me? I be trying to find ground in my own mind, and it's like I don't get no help in that aspect. But it's like, I'll go to like thinking like this, I'll be tired. I'm tired of feeling tired, bro.
From the dark side in, does anybody here wanna be my friend?
Okay, guys, so basically this is what I wanted to explain today, just based off of what I've learned. You have to take a second to sit down to thoroughly observe your patterns. Do you move when you don't want to move? Do you get angry when you don't want to get angry? You have to fix these things about yourself. You have to give a fuck about yourself, and that makes life so much better. Like, I'm learning to do it now, and it makes life 10 times better. It makes you feel better. I want you to start a journal.
That's when the internal change was happening. He was actually changing internally, trying to preach a positive message because he kind of had a negative impact, and he wanted to balance that out.
I'm going to stop calling you guys fans. I'm going to start calling you members of my cult. This is a cult, not a fan base.
Or we have this big family of a fan base, and there's a lot of us that are depressed, myself, including myself. There's a lot of us that are depressed, so just hashtag my name and find another person that listens to my music and help them through their problems. So here's what we'll do. We'll start a hashtag today. I want you to get this trending. Hashtag, you tell me your problems and I'll tell you mine. And we will use this hashtag to communicate with other fans and friends and that listen to my music that need help.
He did not want that image to follow him around for the rest of his life. But when it comes to his relationship with Geneva, I do sincerely think that he wanted to fix his relationship with her privately. But between the law, the case, and then the public, that was like an impossible task. He had what's called a no contest order of protection against Geneva.
Under the assumption love is dead already, let me be here.
One of the girls that he was living with, she hit me up on Instagram. She told me that Jossie wanted to speak to me. And I was like, what? I ended up speaking to him. I was on FaceTime with him. And he was telling me that he wanted to meet up and apologize to me. And I was really scared because I didn't know if it was a setup. I was like still very afraid of him. So I was scared, but I just had to like overcome it. I felt like I had to face my problems.
Reporting live from Florida with the alleged hurricane.
We'd like hang out here and there. I spent a whole weekend with him during a hurricane, and like nobody even knew. People online would be like, they hate each other. But in reality, like we were talking. For me, like, I found sympathy and empathy in the situation, and I was able to literally just, like, forgive him because I feel like I basically compared it to my mother. Like, my mother has abused me, and you don't see people disowning their mother because of that. Well, you do, but not necessarily in every instance.
They both had an opinion on what should happen. But at some point, the state of Florida wanted otherwise.
When Geneva sent in her affidavit to say she no longer wanted to pursue criminal charges, I think that prompted them to go through the jail calls. You know, there was so much stuff on there, they easily charged Jossie with a bunch of new counts of witness tampering.
Okay, guys, so I was just given 7 more charges by the state attorney's office, and I have a court date on the 15th. So I would ask that everyone come to support me. I ask that the people that do come bearing positive energy.
He had this court date in December. The day before, I was asking him, like, what's the worst thing that could happen tomorrow? He answered that he'd be taken in for a couple hours, and they'd be able to get him out that same day.
The fans took over the whole courthouse. They were calling the judge, like doing all kinds of crazy stuff. As soon as we walked in the room, you could feel the energy from the judge. He didn't even get a chance to say a word. She just started going in.
Sir, would you stop lying to all your friends? We know your friends are in here to watch you make a fuss, make you take it little videos for you. Please stop lying to get out.
It seemed like she just knew in her mind she was going to take him that day to make an example of, you don't have more power than we do.
They ended up taking him in for a week.
All those charges added up. So I believe he was looking at 20 years. Now, because of his status, it requires him to be segregated in solitary, not being in general population. He doesn't have access to sitting and talking to people or anything that can stimulate him. And he already struggled with hearing voices in his head and
being alone anytime in, you know, locked up in solitary would be a problem for him. And we knew that.
It doesn't matter how many times he spoke about, like, helping each other or something like that. It was always, okay, but he beat Geneva. Like, he can never have a conversation without that being, going back to being the topic.
And why is that wrong?
Why is it wrong?
How do you fully redeem yourself if every time on every corner, it just keeps popping up?
But how do you fully redeem yourself without ever admitting that you did something wrong?
He acknowledged that there was a situation, you know, but self-acknowledgement and accountability, do I have to hold myself accountable and admit it to the world just for you guys to judge me anyways? They were gonna judge him no matter what, you know, without knowing the full story. It didn't matter if he spoke that full story, they were gonna judge him no matter what. And that's all he was going through, was being judged. He could release a number one album, you could love his song, but then they were still judging him based on that situation. It wasn't something he was able to escape, even though he was holding himself accountable.
But he wasn't telling the truth about it publicly.
I think it also might have resulted in them taking his whole life away.
Yeah.
I think it makes sense that that's an apology that needs to be kind of more planned out in a way that, like, has an actual beneficial result and not one that, you know, results in somebody getting their entire freedom and life taken away.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I do think he would have gotten to a place where he would have gotten there. He just never had a chance to.
I got a call from a well-known psychologist by the name of Dr. Michael Brennan. The judge decided that I was going to work with him. The judge pointed at me and says, everywhere you go, he's got to go. You got to go. He can't go anywhere without you. Well, the first day, it was people in here galore. I didn't want to go right then and there in a sit-down face-to-face because from a cultural kind of background, the connotations of therapy and counseling perception is what goes along with that. I'm crazy, I'm loco, and I ain't crazy. As a matter of fact, he mentioned that, you know, ain't nothing wrong with me, you're crazy. I said, man, let's walk, let's just walk. Man, I got problems like anybody else. I said, look, I'm here, man, you know, to treat you like a human being. It's about your life, man. It's a bigger picture to me. I'm concerned about you. And he looked like that, pointed at me, he's like, straight. I do
not at all want any guy was rule-based. He was like, yo, you got to clean this shit up. Way too many people in and out of your house, bro. You can't control what these people are going to do. Something bad is going to happen. Yo, you know what? You can't have all these women in your house. It's going to lead to something. You just pick one and call it a day. You know, he picked Jen.
Before me and Joe ever dated, we're not two people that were looking for anything at all. He actually wanted me to be his assistant. Ja always saw me as this very nurturing, caring person, and he felt very safe when he was with me, and I did too. So he just kind of said, like, you're my girlfriend now, and if you don't want to be here, you don't have to be, but if you want to, I would love for you to be. I'm like, okay, I can be your rock, you can be mine. I will say there were some days I felt like I was definitely walking on shards of glass because you didn't know what you were going to get.
We would have sessions. We would just sit down and talk and laugh. Whatever his pain or whatever he was going through, whatever he wanted to talk to me about, personal, family kind of stuff. And I recognized then that this was a traumatized human being, unable to grieve. And he had to play out the macho. He's 5'2". He's going to play out this macho, the rap, the hip-hop, and all this. There ain't chance. And he's dealing with an enormous amount of emotion and a lot of stuff. I never could be his biological father, and that was not my role. But if anything, that I could be there and that I didn't want money from him, it was about him, just as a human being that deserved the dignity and the respect.
She gon' woohoo me, ayy, just like a song. Ride on my dick like a blunt, ride on my dick like a blunt. Her booty bit like a pimple, pop that pussy like a pimple.
And I know this from what Cleo and Solomon and everyone told me. It's like when I was around making music with him, that's when he was happy. I realized that like the process of making music and being able to put his mind on something was what allowed him to free his mind off of all the other places that it was going.
That's scary, bro. Bro, once you learn how to use your vocal range, you can do some crazy shit.
He was putting down big records, and it was exciting to watch.
This damage, and the way I feel can't manage.
He was on house arrest, and going to the studio and having to be home at a certain time became an issue. And so we decided to knock out the closets and build a studio in home for him. Whenever he gets into the mood, it's right there.
There's the X. I remember, like, there was a day in early January that he was asking me if I had any beats. And I said, yeah, I have beats from this person and this producer and that producer. And he said, no, you. And so I reached over and kind of logged into my Box account on his computer. And before I could click on anything, because I was so nervous, I was trying to figure out what to play him, he clicked on something called Sad Banjo, which turned out to be the beat for Sad. And in maybe like 5 or 10 minutes, he wrote that whole song.
Someone that's afraid to let go. So
sad. Oh, that's nice. That's dope. You decide, yeah. Who am I? Yeah.
Who am I?
Someone that's afraid to let go.
You decide.
Mm-hmm.
That's fire.
Yeah. Like the day we got the mix of Sad back, yeah, I remember us kind of looking at each other and being like, this is different. There was always this desire to have something that just would kind of set him apart from everyone else that he was being compared to at the time. And this would have been a song where there's zero rapping on it. And the idea of this song coming out, especially at the same time as a song called Changes, that excited me and it excited him. And then when those two songs came out, I felt like the entire world changed. And, you know, in the Sad music video, he kills his former self, and he was really deliberate.
Transitioning into the blue hair was Indigo Child coming into himself and realizing his responsibility to this generation. You know, him and I had a conversation about what are you going to be? What do you want these kids to walk away with? You know what I'm saying? What's your message? And he realized he had an obligation that was bigger than himself. And so he chose to take that path.
Okay, so my current focus is creation and evolution. It's better to be respected through love rather than fear, simply because, like, all right, I was respected through fear, and it's not real love. It's not real love, and it drives people away. It makes people treat you differently. It makes people really, like, it's just not genuine. It's not what you really would want. Like, it's better not to be a crazy motherfucker. It's better not, because I've went through that. There was a point where I wanted to be the villain, and it's not fun, bro. It's not fun. It doesn't attract anything that you truly want. I've started to look at myself very differently and beat myself up. And you guys are the only thing that gives me hope. You guys are the only things that thing that motivates me to ideally, like, yo, be strong. You have over 8 million kids
or adults and teenagers watching you, relying on you for this hope.
Jesse was becoming more patient. He was more positive versus being so angry all the time. You can reason with him because he was able to reason with himself.
When a nigga would just usually freak out and trip out, you would see him go into a corner and do breathing exercises. You feel me? Keep his eyes closed, meditate, even if it's for like a little 10 minutes, then come back and address the situation.
One day I get home and I'm like, something doesn't feel right. Literally the next day I took a pregnancy test. And sure enough, I find out that I'm pregnant. John had like 30 phones. It was so ridiculous. So I'm like sending the picture to all these phones because I couldn't get a hold of him. Turns out he was at the gym training. Finally, when I got a hold of John, he was super excited. Like, he was like, no way.
Family and success.
Cheers. Cheers.
I almost felt like he knew how to relate to kids more than he did other people. He saw this emotional phenomenon in children that they were pure and unable to judge and unable to have hatred in their heart. And he loved that so much that the idea of having a kid of his own and being able to instill this sense of acceptance and lovingness and positivity within this kid would have been his proudest moment.
Then in one incident, I had took him to Nobu. It was his first time eating at a fancy restaurant. And they pulled up, and we were sitting down eating, and he was fucking around with the chopsticks. And we were just sitting there, and we started talking about kids. And he was like, you're gonna be a great dad. I said, you're gonna be a great dad too someday, bro. And he said, no, I'm not. So what do you mean? And he just looked me dead in the eye, and he was like, I'm not gonna make it past 21. And then just went right back to fucking with the chopsticks. Like, he hadn't said a thing.
He always spoke about death and was fascinated with it, I think, since he was about 15. It's almost as if he was preparing me that he wasn't going to be here. His lawyers called and told me that they were coming to pick Ja up Tuesday. I had the worst anxiety ever. I went to the studio and he was working on his first beat. And he was so proud. And I was so proud because I was like, yo, where did you come from? How did you even learn to do these things, you know? He spoke about possibly running. And I was like, Ja, where are you gonna go? You have blue hair with tats all over your face. You're not exactly gonna blend in with the crowd. And he was like, I don't understand what's happening or why. And I said, kid, you're powerful. I said, I've watched you control your crowd and your audience. I said, that's dangerous to the status quo. He got up from around the table and he said, to whom much is given, much is required. And then he said, you know, I'm gonna go buy a bike. And I was like, what? Why? Because at the time he had about 3 bikes in the garage and then some other ones at his other house that he doesn't even ride them. But I knew my son. I knew it was because he was so worried. He was so scared. Typically, I'd be like arguing with him about those type of things, if it doesn't make sense. But I knew what that was. And so I was like, okay, let me get security together for you. And he was like, nah, they're going to take too long. I called Jazz's brother, which is Aiden's dad. I called him and I was like, hey, Ja wants to go pick up this bike. I'm going to need you to drive his car back in the event that he does get the bike. And I said, no matter what he says, don't leave his side.
I
Remember I walked home that day, content with all my misery. Told myself it'd get better, no clue what there was next to me. Remember there was people walking, talking in the distance. I was dressed for winter weather, but the summer rays were kissing me. I was lost. So I took a different path. In the distance, he awaited me. Had no weapon, I'm guessing his hands were just enough for me. Was no question, I'm guessing he laughed just at the sight of me. And there he was. His presence was alarming. As he approached, was casual, we talked about self-harming. He told me, kid, you shouldn't be walking on your own. He smiled and laughed and pat my back. He asked, how far are you from home? I said, maybe 30 minutes. His frequency distorted quick. I seen it in his image. I should've run right fucking there. You ever woke up on the train track? When the motherfucking clothes on, step before your eyes, you pray to God, but ain't no response. Trying to scream for hope, just so that you can lean on. But ain't nobody coming, so you scream on and scream on and scream on. While the evil fuck laugh at you, train getting closer, you still surprised that he battered you. Tears falling harder and harder, minutes get minuscule. Could've had a son or a daughter, now what you finna do?
When I got the call, yeah, I just collapsed to the floor.
Bro, I think X got shot, bro. I think X got shot, bro. I think X got shot, bro. I think X got shot.
I'm like, they did what? And what do you mean they shot Justin?
I remember not having any gas, not wanting to stop. Trying to get to where he was, and it's all a blur.
And I just remember like calling Cleo, like, Cleo, where are you? She's like, I'm lost. She like literally didn't know where she was. I'm like, bro, you gotta get somewhere. We're at the hospital. She's like, I'm trying to get there. But she's like, I don't know where I'm at.
I was like disoriented. I got there. There was a few people there already. I'm not sure how they found out. And I was just in there for mad long, pacing back and forth. I wasn't able to go back there. They gave me some bullshit story about them not wanting me to see him like that because it would traumatize me, but I think that I should have made that decision of seeing my son.
And then it's like that calm, just it was like a calm that set in because it's like, all right, it's Jesse, he's ready, like he's a fighter. He's a fighter, Jesse's gonna make it through him. Nobody's gonna make it through, it's gonna be him.
The cops came out, and they pulled me in a room. And I remember the officer was just so callous when he delivered. He was just like, oh, Jesse expired today at such and such time.
I still don't understand what he means by expired.
That shit just seemed like watching a movie or something. I don't know. I never come to terms with it.
It went from that to just planning a funeral. I remember Cleo walking in the room and saying, how do we plan a funeral? How do I plan a funeral for my son?
Soul to keep, hope's not too late for me. Lord, lay me down to sleep. Pray, Lord, my soul to keep, hope's not too late for me. Difference changing in the distance, time consumes the image. Down to sleep, pray the Lord my soul to keep. Hope's not too late for me. Whoa.
That's not a toy. That's not a toy.
His son isn't old enough to carry on his legacy. There's nobody that can do it. So I have to not only be here for my other son, I have to be here to maintain his legacy as well as look out for my grandson. Ja was my practice baby. I was 17 years old. There's nobody teaching me how to take care of a child. I just had to kind of figure it out. Ja kind of changed my mindset from hammering, you're gonna do this, you're gonna do that, because you will lose your child doing that. You have to allow them to be themselves.
After Jossie died, Cleo reached out to me like a year later. So she calls me, and before I answer the phone, I'm like, oh my God, like, I don't know if this is gonna be bad or good. I was like alleviated, but really nervous.
You know, this is, my son's no longer here, and I feel like it's up to me now to make amends for any mistakes that he's done and try to right his wrongs as much as I can. I would actually like to hear you tell your story because, like I said, my son died and he's never admitted it to me. I don't think he would want me to see him in that light or know those things, that side of him. You know, just say, was wrong for what he did. You know, there's no excuse for that, period. You know, but I just want the world to know that he wasn't that same person anymore. And that whether it's the past is still a part of his story.
Now, Cleo and I are cool. It makes me feel like a weight is lifted, basically. Because, like, I felt like I wasn't accepted by the whole family the whole time.
I'm not gonna hate her, and my son's not here, and I don't think she should be mistreated in any way. This is about his legacy, and she is the love of his life, and she was a part of that legacy.
People have, like, asked me for advice, and I just feel bad sometimes because, like, I don't know how I feel about telling other people what to do or, like, how to feel about that because I feel like it's just different with every person.
It's crazy to think that really and truly that at the end of the story, that Jossie's legacy is going to really help so many fucking lives. So hard to explain, but this dude turned everything around for the better.
He sent out a parachute with his name on it. I think he wanted to talk about suicide and those types of things to help somebody. Really, he wanted to save somebody.
It could go a lot of ways for me, but I just know that I have to make Jossie proud. I have to, because I know I'm gonna see him again in some cosmic plan. Some cosmic plan, I'm gonna see Ja again, and that's what I live my life based off of. Don't blame me, I take